This is the number one offense in New England, right here. Right here!
Let's take a peek and see what we got. That's it.
You're gonna go for it. You're gonna have some ups and downs, but we're coming over the top of them.
That's it. That's his ring.
We're coming right over the top. They haven't played against a team like this. They have not played against a team like this. Keep your poise and let's roll over that, right? Over that.
Enclosed, please find the much discussed ring from the 2000 Norwood Mustang undefeated football team. I wish you a lot of luck finding to who it belongs to. And I'm very curious what the final chapter of the story will be. Hope you I'm just shaking. It's just so incredible. Hope you and it makes its way back to the fingers of the person who lost it, and that we'll be able to tell the great fishing story. I can't even finish it.
So it was at least 2 years ago, easily 2 years ago, that we were out fishing, and I'll never forget. It was my uncle, George, my father, my buddy, George Holmesy, my family friend, Steve Bartell, up from New Hampshire. It was probably five or six of us all down the canal. And within the spacing of us, that's probably about 30 feet.
The day that we were fishing for those, it was just like any other day. The fish that we were catching, we would release. If there was one that we ended up wanting to keep for ourselves or for the family or whatever, we would bring that home. But it was just any other day, typical day. We were fishing down the east end of the canal.
And the fishing was incredibly hot that day. We're out there. I mean, as soon as the lure hit the water, fish would just jump out of the water and just take it. So I'll never forget it. So I catch one fish, get it in, and we're out there for about an hour to 2 hours between the change of the tides.
And it was probably just before 6 o'clock, he decided to keep a fish. One of the fish on that morning, after he had let several of them go, he decided he wanted to keep one of those fish. And he brought the fish, after he caught it, he brought the fish up the rocks. And in doing so, he slipped on the rocks. The rocks are very slippery on the canal.
Climb back up the rock in the canal, and all of a sudden I'm like, oh no, I don't feel my ring. My ring's not on my finger. Now the gentleman that was to the left of me goes, hey, you leaving, can I grab your spot? I said, sure, go ahead. Went to my spot. As soon as I look back, after noticing my ring was gone, I see the gentleman bend down, pick something up. Now I'm like, oh, did he pick up a fishing lure? Did I drop my ring?
He spent about 45 minutes trying to get it with it, and his cousin helped him out, trying to get it out of the rocks. To no avail. He couldn't see it, but he kept searching and searching and searching. All the time that he was searching, we kept fishing, not really realizing what had been going on.
As far as I'm concerned, it's gone. There's only a handful of people I tell my father, because he could tell something was genuinely wrong with me, because I was looking frantically and he could tell I was in an upset mood and whatnot. Told my girlfriend, obviously, told only a handful of people. So not many people knew that I lost the ring, because it was kind of upsetting to me. It was actually really upsetting to me.
Hi, I'm Terry Riley of the Channel Fish Company. And right here is the beginning of quite a fish story. So there's cutting houses all around Boston, right? And Maine and Gloucester, Canada. They cut their fillets for the restaurant or the shop or whatever. Whatever's left over is the racks and the tails and the heads. So they put them in tubs for us, and then we grind it all up for pet food. So the guys right now are on the table. They're sorting through the fish by hand, looking for foreign material, looking for metals, looking for any irregularities in the fish. that might hurt the product. What we find usually are hooks, staples, that kind of thing. All right, this is Cesar. Cesar last year was cutting a striper fish looking for metal because it went through the metal detector and it got hit with metal and they couldn't find it. So what they do is they cut the fish and looking for metal to see if they can find anything in there. So last year at this time, when Cesar was looking through it, he found a ring. So what he did was he gave it to his supervisor, Carlos, to see if he could just say, hey, this, I found this ring, it's something different. So he put it upstairs into the office, and that's when I got it, and I reached out to the athletic director at Norwood High School, and he reached out to Jack, who's a public access director at Norwood Public Access, and that started the journey of finding where the ring went.
I was talking to Coach Buzzy Curran one day, and he had asked me if I'd heard about the fish ring story. And I had no idea what he was talking about, and I learned from Buzzy that this ring was found inside a fish and was returned back to Norwood High. I was fascinated and I wanted to learn more. And he had told me that the ring was in the athletic director's office. So I went down the hall and talked with John Longley, the athletic director, and he had told me that the ring was shipped to him from the fishing plant in East Boston, and there was no name on the ring. So he struggled on how to return the ring. So I decided to make a little project of my own, and with producer Mike Maloof and I, we went through the yearbook and looked at all the players and the coaches and tried to come up with a number of how many rings that probably existed back in 2000. So my next step was to find out from the ring company how many were made. So I called Jostin's Ring, and then I called Balfour Ring, and no one had any record of the rings being produced. So my next step was, I thought I would call Norwood Bank. Norwood Bank always steps up in these kind of situations and helps for these fundraising activities. So I called the president, Chris Dixon, whose son happened to be on the team as well. And Chris told me that for sure Norwood Bank definitely stepped up and helped out for the cost of the rings. But he did suggest that Sean Keegan might be able to tell me the number of rings produced because he was involved in helping the parents design the ring and helping this project go smoothly. So I decided to go down to Keegan's Jewelers unannounced. I walked right in and talked with Sean. And as soon as I told Sean that I had a ring that was found inside a striped bass, he told me right away who the ring belonged to.
And I said to Jack, could you bring it down so I could take a look at it? And Jack, of course, jumping like a little kid at Christmas, had to run back and get that ring and bring it down to me with cameras. And of course, he got some of the good footage of me losing my stuff, but it brought the ring down. As soon as that ring was in my hand, I knew that was his ring. Because I had worked on it with my boy for so long and knew the ring inside and out. And I knew how the stone was held in. I knew how he set the stone. And yeah, that was his ring.
Once we learned that the ring belonged to Sean, we wanted to learn more. I was intrigued with the whole story. And I wanted to find out, you know, why did he make this ring? How did he make this ring? And what did the ring mean to him?
It just basically was something that he was driven to do, that he was proud of it, and he still wears it till the day he lost it. He wore it with a lot of pride and a lot of love.
I made it instead of making my class having a class ring, high school class ring, I made a high school Super Bowl ring to basically remember the time that I had with all my good friends and buddies playing football and our high school careers together. And it also meant a lot to me because I made the ring by hand myself.
What I think about the ring now, after the event has gone by, my father's fishing derby, and some time has passed, and you know, I see the emotions of my wife when she accepted the ring on stage. It's just still awe-inspiring. And as I talk to a few friends and family, and they hear the story, it's mind-blowing to think that it could have made this journey down south, migrated with that fish down to the Chesapeake Bay where they spawn in the spring, and then come back up this way. And find its way to the right place and the right time to get, you know, recognized as what it was versus being, you know, found and sold as for the gold or or maybe another fish ate it and died on the bottom of the ocean, or, I mean, many of things could have happened to that ring. It just was, it's pretty special, and I really, I'd say 99% attributed to my father. Of him, his ashes were spread out at Nantucket when he passed, and every time we fish, I feel that my father is with me, and I just feel that he was looking out for, you know, his grandson, looking out for his son, and made that fish kind of come back.
It blows my mind. It's incredible. I mean, extremely lucky. Not just to have to lose something in the ocean or near the ocean, or better yet, in a fish, especially the kind of fish that migrate at the end of the season. They migrate down south and then they'll migrate back. I mean, the odds of that fish getting caught are very, very, very high. But the odds of it getting caught back here in Boston and then going and being processed through the different manufacturers and then back in my hands, better yet, back on my finger, that's very incredible, you know? I just feel very, very lucky.
So for all those things to work and happen and then end up going to that processing plant up in Boston, it just, you have to believe in miracles, and I believe in my father.
I just want to thank everybody along the lines that has gotten back to me, from basically the fishermen that caught the fish all the way from the processing plants that processed it, and it changed hands several times before it finally got back to me, from athletic directors, Jack Tolman, the guys at the manufacturer, especially the guys at the manufacturer. You don't see honesty like that every day, especially when they know they can just take it and go down to a pawn shop or whatnot and sell it. So I really, really appreciate it, everybody, and I want to thank you.